16 days to Election Day, and here is the biggest question. Can Donald Trump change this map? Can Donald Trump find a path to victory, meaning a path to 270 electoral votes? You see how we have it right now, lopsided for Joe Biden. 290 electoral votes now, either solid or leading Biden's way. Only 163 for President Trump. So he needs to engineer a huge comeback. Look at the toss-up states on our board, plus Maine's 2nd Congressional District. Just look at these toss-up states. Let's assume they've all voted Republican before. They all voted Republican in 2016. Even if Trump won Iowa, won Ohio, won North Carolina, won Georgia, and won Florida, even if he swept the toss-up states on our board, it would still not be enough. Joe Biden would still have the lead. Donald Trump's hill is steeper than steep because Joe Biden is competitive in every one of these states. And yet, Democrats are nervous, warning against complacency, worried they have seen this movie before. 16 days out, here's the biggest question. Can you find a viable path to victory for Donald Trump, a viable path to 270 electoral votes? Well, it's incredibly difficult because of the state of play right now. We have Hillary Clinton at 307 electoral votes, Donald Trump at just 179. Takes 270 to win. Can Trump turn it around? Yes, but it would be extraordinarily hard. With us this Sunday, Lisa Lair of the New York Times and NPR's Asma Khalid. That's a little creepy when you look back at the flashback, but that is where we were 4 years ago on this day. The question, Asma, is the Biden campaign sent out this email from the campaign manager yesterday to supporters and donors saying, don't believe the numbers. Please don't believe the numbers. But one of the interesting things about this race that makes a difference is the stability. If you go back to Joe Biden's lead, this is NBC Wall Street Journal polling, a 12-point lead over Donald Trump at the beginning of the year. There you go, right there, a 9-point lead now if you play it out there. So stability in the lead. If you look at the biggest, most important voting group in America, that is women voters. Let me try to slide this one over here. Look at this. This is the gender gap, NBC Wall Street Journal numbers. It was big at the beginning of the year. It is even bigger now. So there are comparisons to 2016, but there also are big differences, including the stability of the Biden lead.
That's right. I mean, I think, you know, for a long time over the summer, I was looking at some sort of inflection point, trying to see if there would be an inflection point. And really, I would say the storyline of the summer leading into the fall has been the remarkable consistency of the polls. You know, that being said, I also think that there are key demographic groups that Joe Biden seems to be doing better with than Hillary Clinton was ever able to do. And chief among them, to me, honestly, John, perhaps the most fascinating demographic group is white voters. We recently did a poll, the NPR PBS NewsHour Marist poll, that actually showed Joe Biden winning with white voters. You know, that is a phenomenal statistic, if true, because no Democrat in recent presidential history has been able to win white voters. You know, I would say I hear the same in my reporting when I was out there doing, you know, interviews with, say, young, disaffected, disillusioned black and brown voters. They may not like Joe Biden, but they understand the stakes are very different than they were in 2016.
Right, and that is a big difference in the sense, Lisa, that you have an incumbent president. Hillary Clinton was viewed by some voters as the incumbent, I guess, because she had been Obama's Secretary of State. But you have an incumbent president in the middle of a pandemic, and the American people have cast a pretty decisive verdict. They don't like what they have seen from the president. And to that, Joe Biden tries to, you know, almost send the message, I'm not flashy, but I'm steady. Listen here to part of his message is, you know, when the president speaks, you must be able to trust it.
The words of a president matter.
Absolutely.
No matter whether they're good, bad, or indifferent, they matter. And when a president doesn't wear a mask or makes fun of folks like me when I was wearing a mask for a long time, then, you know, people say, well, it mustn't be that important.
I always joke, my first campaign was 1988. Michael Dukakis said this election is not about ideology, it's about competence. I guess he was 30 years ahead of his time.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's been the message that Joe Biden has had since the beginning. He's cast his candidacy as sort of a return to normalcy, where voters don't have to think about what's coming out of the White House every single day, and they can escape this chaotic tone of this administration, a tone that, and a, you know, feeling that's only escalated in the midst of this extraordinary pandemic. But I also think it's really important to remember something else about 2016, which was that then, as you point out, Donald Trump was, of course, running against Hillary Clinton. And when you look at the numbers, you had a race between two of the most divisive, polarizing candidates that the country had seen in a really long time. That is not this race. I mean, I've talked to people who have run focus groups for both candidates, and those who ran focus groups for Hillary Clinton recounted voters giving this tortured sort of explanation of her personality and whether they could vote for her. And even if they didn't like Trump, they felt like maybe Hillary Clinton had been in the public eye in a divisive way for too long. And when I've talked to people who've run focus groups for Joe Biden, they say what they hear from voters is that people don't know a lot about him, but, you know, they like him. So he has a very different brand, a very different reputation in the American public, and that's really helping him in this moment.
But you have both spent time in recent days talking to the people who drive American politics, and that would be women. Women will be 50% plus, probably 52-53% of the electorate nationally. It'll be around that number, higher in some states as we get through it. Asma, this is from a piece you did. I think we trust him after seeing what he's done. That's a lot of our reservations. I don't know that we like him, but our goal isn't be liked, it's to be respected. That from Linda Holloway out in very important Bloomfield, Michigan. She's a Trump supporter. And Lisa, this is from your reporting. In the last 4 years, my children have grown and developed more than he has in regards to the way he speaks to other people, the way he speaks about other people. That from an Ohio voter who's going to vote for Biden now, who voted for Gary Johnson last time. Asma, to you first. When you talk to these women, especially suburban women, who, again, that is why Nancy Pelosi is speaker. The suburban revolt against Trump in 2018 changed America. The question is, will it change America again?
Mm-hmm. So, you know, I was out in Michigan and I specifically spent time in two key congressional districts that did flip from Republican to Democrat in 2018. And what I consistently heard from, you know, you could call them suburban women, right? This is a key demographic that the Donald Trump had been pleading to support him. They said that they were sort of awakened to politics in 2018. Many of them are energized and engaged far more so this election cycle. You know, I think where Donald Trump still retains support in the suburbs is among sort of a key core base of women who say, you know, we don't like how he speaks, but we're still going to back him. The challenge for him is that is, you know, less than 50% of the public. And really, at this point, he needs to be expanding the base. He has shown no sign, specifically among suburban women, that he's capable of doing that.
And Lisa, your voter there is important because the third party candidates are not polling anywhere near like they did last time. So you have a Johnson supporter from 16 who's a Biden supporter now. In the newspaper today, you also write about other disaffected Democrats or independents who couldn't vote for Hillary Clinton who can vote for Biden. So as we talk about Trump trying to find new voters, Biden may have a pool too.
Right. When we look at the numbers for people who voted third party, which, as you point out, isn't as strong and doesn't have as strong of appeal this time around or didn't vote at all in the 2016 election, a lot of what we're seeing is those people are in higher numbers going to Joe Biden. But I do think, as you point out, the suburbs will be key here. Republicans have really never won a presidential race in recent history without running the suburbs, winning the suburbs. And part of what's happening here is the suburbs are changing. I think Donald Trump, when he tries to, you know, talk about suburban housewives and law and order and win back these areas of the country, the suburbs, he doesn't quite have a sense of what they are now. They're increasingly diverse. They're the bulk of America. These are areas that have followed a lot of the demographic trends that are hurting the Republican Party in the long term. And so the question is not only whether Donald Trump will lose these areas and perhaps cost himself the presidency, but whether Republicans can win them back, or are these voters lost for the Republican Party for a very long time?
That's a fascinating, one of the fascinating questions we will deal with in the next 16 days and then beyond. Asma, Lisa, grateful for the reporting and the insights.